Hello everyone, and welcome to another Dwarven Tavern video. We are your hosts, Dr. Jeff Goins.
Lyric Goins.
Ian Goins.
And this time we're going to be talking to you. This is another racially charged video. And this time we're talking about those little guys that everybody loves, we think.
Mostly.
Some people don't like them.
Nine-tenths of the gaming world.
I generally don't associate with people that don't like these guys. The Hobbits, or the Halflings, as they are known in the various gaming books that we have open before us.
I think all three of these refer to them as Halflings.
Well, yeah. Even the humans in The Lord of the Rings, they sang a song called Hail to the Halflings. Because humans refer to Hobbits as Halflings.
Because they're half their size.
Habits. Heard of them sales as habits. Hobbits refer to themselves as hobbits, just like we call them the Japanese, and the Japanese call themselves
Nihonjin.
So,
quiz.
I was in Nihongo, but that's the language.
Yeah, it's like Zhongwen, Zhongguo.
Right. There's a very distinct difference.
Exactly.
Moving
Chinese
on.
People. Chinese people speakage. So, we've been discussing the whole premise of the halflings and what they have become and where they started and what they are in the various gaming systems. And Lyric is she's kind of in charge of the 5th edition halflings. I've got the Pathfinder halflings, and Ian's got the 3.5 halflings, and which is appropriate. Halflings 3.5.
jokes. He's got them.
It's comedy.
Really accurate.
So what do we think?
Let's start out with talking about where the hobbits come from, because they're not exactly part of normal folklore like elves or dwarves.
Or are they?
But the point I'm trying to make is that the biggest influence of hobbits and halflings came from Tolkien first. That is the first real introduction to their race.
Yeah.
And that's where...
Definitely the most popular.
Yeah. That's where all of the knowledge of halflings are at least derived from.
Doesn't that kind of make it canon?
I would say so, but, I mean, in order for copyright infringement to not be a part of it, they have to derive it just a tiny bit.
Yeah, you gotta deviate.
Just a little bit.
It's Tolkien influenced.
Yes.
You know.
That's like a paying an homage. I'm fancy. So, Tolkien is the epitome of what a halfling is, and Dungeons & Dragons, Pathfinder, any other role-playing game that uses them is a step, in a individual direction that makes it just slightly different. For example, Tolkien elves, I almost said, Tolkien hobbits are...
Tolkien
I don't know where my
hobbits.
Mind is right now, but it's apparently with the elves.
Neither are Tolkien dwarves hobbits.
Right.
Tolkien hobbits
are also not hobbits.
Focus. Tolkien hobbits are homebodies. They love agriculture. They love animals. They love eating.
Same animals.
Very seldomly do you find a hobbit or halfling that wants anything to do with traveling. In fact, it's even almost a taboo to talk about adventuring. These books, more often than not, you find that hobbits and halflings want to travel. They have a sort of wanderlust on this page right now. So these creatures are slightly different. That and their appearance also changes a lot, which
irritating as anything I've ever been irritated with. The appearance.
When Tolkien describes hobbits, they are described as looking identical to human children with really big fuzzy feet and really wildly curly hair. They don't have facial hair, and their hair color ranges from auburn to brown. Very seldomly do you find a blonde. They don't have pointed ears. They have big noses, but not like dwarven big. Just like little button noses that are just like meep.
A dwarven nose is probably about 50% of their face.
So, I mean, they're...
And weight.
So they're basically just, they look like human children, but portly. Because they like to eat. And their physical attributes vary so much so in these game systems that they kind of lose that illusion. They become not human children, but elven children.
Yeah.
They're usually portly, but I don't think I've ever seen a fat hobbit.
Well, they are described as fat in the Tolkienverse. Yeah. So
they're just kind of like, just got a gut.
Pudgy, they're just an itty bitty pudge.
Yeah, but I don't think I've ever seen, like, an obese hobbit.
No, I'm not talking about, like, fat rolls. I'm talking about, like, he had a very big feast one time and never went away.
I have to admit, though, a really fat hobbit would be very fun to play.
It might have to happen.
Because if he had a half-orc in the party, he would probably have a like habit of kicking around.
Brown Feet. Was that his name in the first movie? The first Lord of the Rings movie? Brown Feet? Like, he was a fat hobbit. He was like, brown foot! And he's like, brown feet!
Proud. The proud foots. He called them the proud foots. And
he's like, proud feet!
Proud feet. Okay. In
was at the birthday party.
In the first edition, Player's Handbook, halflings are very much like small humans, according to the book. As player characters, it is assumed that any of the sub-race of halflings can be considered as that of the halfling character in question. And then it talks about what they can be. In the first edition, they get saving throws on... they get plus one on their saving throws, right? They get plus one against poison because they're highly resistant to poison, and they have infravision.
She has drawn-on eyebrows. They are so drawn on.
She's entirely drawn on. That's a piece of art.
No, but they don't even match her hair color.
Her entire head is drawn on.
Okay, but look. It looks like a straight pen stroke, and not there's not that's not yeah. hair.
Oh, I forgot.
It's an eyebrow.
So, the first edition hobbits are kind of the truest, in my opinion. To the
they're almost carbon copies
to the Tolkienian hobbits. Jeez.
Tolkienverse hobbits.
And they're not listed here.
For some reason.
That's weird. But the derpiest half word ever.
Well, I try to have to go every time I see that photo. I'm gonna have to take a photo of that and show it.
Yeah,
I still love the fact that everyone has the expression as if he just told a horrible joke.
Well, the artwork in the first edition.
Oh,
was,
it's glorious. Don't even lie to yourself.
It is the best.
Totally glorious.
It's what you live by.
I did for many years. But I don't even know if there's a picture of a hobbit in here.
I don't think so. Maybe that's why it's so up for debate in the other books.
I think there is. I'm pretty sure I've seen it. There's two hobbits standing next to each other.
I think there is in the first edition monster manual. But. The
hobbits.
The first edition book did not stray. Okay, they did not stray from the canon halflings. Second edition, I think, also maintained the furry feet, the round ears, the curly hair, curly brown hair. Looking often, and see that as another thing too. In the early works, halflings were often they said they were masters of hiding because they were mistaken for children.
Yeah,
And nobody paid attention to children in those days.
Yeah, because you don't know when they're going to die off. They just
right.
Oh, well,
yeah,
that one's
just,
gone
the children
now.
Should be seen and not heard.
Just ran out into the field and said, "Huh?
Well, he's gone forever."
You know, I wonder if those cows are carnivorous.
Is
it? Do you think the variation of their physical appearance was because Gary Gygax wasn't in charge of third edition on? Well, did he have any influence on third edition on?
I'm not really certain when Gary left the when he left the fold.
Because
I remember
it
him
says by Gary Gygax on the.
So it was. I think it was right after second edition, or maybe before second edition was released.
So I feel like that would have a greater influence on the change.
Yeah.
So third 3.5 edition is the one that we know the best about.
Yes, and also make us probably the most furious. Because, well, here's the thing. They've always been known as the half-humans. The tiny half. They're not half something else. They're just small people. Because, and that's always bugged me so much, because it's always very specifically half-humans.
That's why they're called halflings, because
they're supposed to look like small people. And then in 3.5, they got changed to these almost, like, it's almost like long-headed elf people.
Miniature elves.
It confused.
Like I said, elf children.
And a piece of artwork in a second edition.
Which I will also put up.
Which is friggin' beautiful.
That's a halfling.
It's a halfling. There's no argument.
It looks like an 8-year-old kid smoking a pipe.
Yeah, with like a
ginormous feet.
Well, it's really interesting because they have like stout adult limbs, a child body, and a child head.
Smoking a pipe.
Smoking a pipe. Isn't
that beautiful?
Because he's probably 3 times older than I am.
He probably so.
Yeah. He's seen some things.
Look at that hair.
That's some wily hair.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a halfling. And they have the hair foot, the tall fellow, and the stout. So that's second edition. I'll put that right there. And I don't know why it went to the miniature elf look.
Like I said, it might have had something to do with the change of influence on who was in charge.
Actually, what's really interesting about this is not only did they change into these small elf people, they also act like small elf people.
Yeah, that's
they
very start true.
They act a lot more like wood elves in 3.5.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where they got like the...
I mean, you even confused my wood elf character for a halfling at one point in time. Elisiana, yeah. She's a wood elf, and you called her, she was like, didn't you play a halfling in that? I'm like, nope.
No, nope. It's crazy.
Completely different.
Yeah. But what's really interesting is, okay, halflings and wood elves shouldn't really act anything alike. Because halflings tend to live in the plains and the hills. Inside the hills.
In the hills.
With, you know, very, very homely, like basically the entire village of bakers.
Or Underhill.
I see what you did there.
So it's like they're super friendly people. They're super low down. And wood elves are... They're basically like woodland hunters that are smaller than everything they hunt.
Yeah.
I imagine like a wood elf to be covered in like they'd be like ghillied up, they'd have the war paint and the super powerful tiny little bows, and they'd be dangerous as all hell.
Because
they're the people that you're walking through the rainforest and all of a sudden a spear goes out of the brushes. I seem to be surrounded. the wood elf, and that's not a hobbit.
No, it's not.
That's not a hobbit. That's
not
a wood elf.
Halfling at all.
They shouldn't even look alike, much less act alike.
Well, a wood elf is a thin person. They're just thinner. They're small framed because they have the elf classification makes them a small framed person. And the thing is, like, you got the dwarves, which are the thickest frames, then you got the elves, which are the thinnest frames, and hobbits are in the middle, like the humans are. Halflings are not thin-framed. So it's like a half-elf and a halfling are, like, the exact same size and look completely different, exactly like humans directly in comparison to elves.
Yeah, so I feel like the closest comparison that you can make, like gnomes, can and do resemble fey creatures because they do have magic. Dwarves resemble the mountains that they are from.
Elves are much closer to the fey than humans are.
Well, I said gnomes. Humans and hobbits are the most closely related of the races that you can identify. So they should look like the closest related that you can identify.
Yeah.
Especially since you mentioned earlier that Tolkien hobbits were eventually supposed to turn into humans.
You know what I just realized?
Yeah.
I don't know why, I just realized this.
Yeah, I was listening.
Okay.
Elves and wood elves are akin to each other just as much as humans and halflings are, as just as much as dwarves are to gnomes.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
So basically you have a micro race of each one.
Yeah.
what is the micro half orc?
Goblin.
Another half orc.
Goblin would actually be the most appropriate.
Half goblin?
Well, yeah, half
would
goblin
be a
because
goblin?
I feel so bad for
a goblin.
Goblin.
I feel so bad for his nose.
Yeah, so because the half orc is not the race that you would use for that.
Yeah,
it would be the
yeah.
orc, and that's the smallest, the small race, the mini race of orc would be a goblin.
Right. So,
given that
distinction, now that we have established canon.
I do want to talk about 5th edition really quickly.
Yeah.
The proportion of this photo, I feel like it was messed up. I feel like it wasn't as well thought out as it could have been. It makes it look like the head is... She would not be able to walk with that head.
if she took a breath of helium, she would float away.
But other than that, I feel like that one is it's slowly going back to the first edition
right.
design.
Which honestly, I think the Pathfinder...
Can I see that?
Yeah.
The picture of the Pathfinder halfling
it's just like,
is actually...
Where did that come from?
Yeah.
It looks like a child elf.
Well, that and the fact that she could put both of her feet in her mouth.
I mean, at
the same time, I mean, look at her how tiny her bits are.
Her bits are tiny.
Her bits are like little baby... Like, itty bitty...
Her foot is the same size as her hand.
That's not right.
It should at least be wider.
Yeah.
Actually, did you notice that her head is actually wider than her hips are?
Yeah.
That's why I'm saying the
so
proportion seems to be...
So this might have just been a rough stylization.
No, I think it was the artist was trying to go for a top-down image, but the loot... Fuck that all to hell. So, they seem to be going back to the more humanistic, although I don't like the fact that she's wearing shoes, because hobbits can't wear shoes. They don't like wearing shoes.
Yeah, they like the earth and their feet.
So they are, even though they have those minor details that are different, they are seeming to go back to the more Tolkien-esque style.
The dwarf's in good proportion here on page 56, and I love the anvil pauldrons.
Dude, his hand is massive.
Yes.
He could crack like 7 walnuts all at once in that fist.
Probably does regularly.
So anyway, talking about not so much their appearance as their personality, the only huge variation from the canon of Tolkienverse is their wanderlust, because hobbits are known for their ability to host.
Well, actually, I think they're more specifically known for the fact that there's a great divide in the realm of hobbits. You've got these hobbits who stay home, who would prefer that outside didn't really even exist.
It's a race of housewives.
Mm. Yeah, like a race of super homey baker housewives.
And then it actually doesn't sound that
and
bad.
And then you've got this branch of hobbits that are like, over there I must go away!
It's
and
just like, where did these guys come from?
Like, are these the same race?
Well, see, the thing is, though, in Tolkien...
That's very interesting to me.
In Tolkien, when Gandalf showed up to take Bilbo to his quest, called him a thief and all that stuff, it was pretty obvious, you know. I mean, and everyone knows that all of the races in the Tolkien books were modeled after certain characters in World War II, I believe it was.
Yes.
Yeah.
No, one.
One? World War One? Okay.
Was it?
Yeah.
Because Tolkien fought in World War One.
Yeah, it was World War
One. He fought one of them.
I think it was World War One.
And so, you know, the orcs, of course, were Huns and... But the hobbits, the halflings, were very much the epitome of what Tolkien envisioned, I believe, as the frightened English countryside people. The very shy, very
happy people, happy farmers living in the hills.
That kept to themselves.
They kept to themselves, were very, they still had this what's the word I'm looking for? This composure, this decorum. Oh, that's highly irregular, you know, that sort of thing. It's like, oh, I don't know that. Don't even talk to me about going anywhere.
Don't even.
and so that's why when Gandalf first approached Bilbo, Bilbo's like, leave the Shire. Are you, you're nuts. You're really big. A. B. You're insane. No, I'm not doing it. And when he did go and come back, everyone was like, I mean, he was like almost shunned because...
Well, when he came back, they all thought he'd been dead.
Yeah, they thought he was dead. They thought he'd died, and they were selling his stuff and all that stuff. And he came back, and everybody thought he was nuts because he left. And that was the general atmosphere. So that whole wanderlust thing, it kind of took me by surprise.
It's very culturally inappropriate for the hobbits. It's not something that their society would embrace.
Hobbits are very, very curious, but they don't really like actually pursuing that curiosity.
However,
they like reading about
it. It's really hard.
Actually, sorry to interrupt you, but to read about it was even kind of a touchy thing because you don't want to know about any of that. That's not important to know about.
And the thing is, though, for gaming purposes, why on earth would you roll up a character that wanted to stay home and be a farmer?
I feel like that would be a great game, though. Like, you stay a gamer for a couple of sessions, and then all of a sudden this half-orc comes in, and you're just like, oh! And he's like, he wants to learn the ways. That actually sounds like a really cool campaign. This half-orc comes in and is like, I want to be a farmer. Can you teach me? And
he's adopted.
He's adopted by the hobbits.
Hobbits are like, you can plow an entire field.
In half a day. So, like, he's...
looks at pony, looks at half-orc.
they watch him carrying the horse, dragging the plow.
With his teeth.
They're like, no, that's it. Oh, no, okay. You're fine. Go ahead.
That would actually just be a really good movie, I think.
Yeah. So, I do understand why, like, that point especially is why they made that wanderlust such a huge thing for this character.
Because you have to have a reason to actually play a halfling.
But at the same time, I feel like the reclusive hobbits as a character is just as cool to explore as a character who actually wants to go out and do it. To have a character like Bilbo that is doing the taboo, or to have a character go into that society and explore something that hasn't been seen in years.
Yeah.
That's a whole other aspect that could be tackled.
It could be.
I mean, they wouldn't be a main race in the book because of that, because that's not something that a main race would, like, have as an attribute.
It's kind of odd to me that hobbits are main race in general.
Well, I think
there aren't as many hobbits as pretty much every other race.
Yeah.
Maybe besides elves and dwarves.
So, I mean, the 5th edition...
I don't think they would outnumber them.
Yeah.
The 5th edition description of their personality, aside from that wanderlust, is actually really appropriate to Tolkien verse.
Yeah.
So...
surprisingly accurate.
Like I said, they ventured out, and they explored it, and when they found out people didn't like it, they kind of went back into the Tolkien verse area of their personality and their looks.
Yeah. So. In the Pathfinder book, it says their ears are pointed, but proportionally not much larger than those of a human. So, again,
So, half-elf ears.
Yeah.
That being said, how and why would you want a halfling in your campaign? What could they bring to your society using the wanderlust that's available?
Actually, I think it states it pretty good in Pathfinder. They remain calm in basically any scenario.
Bilbo was not that one. Bilbo was under constant nervousness.
These hobbits have a trait that very few of the races have. Actually, the dwarves have it, where you attack them, and they actually become more proud. Like, hobbits are almost impossible to intimidate. And they are incredibly, like, they're stalwart as all hell.
I feel like that goes against.
No, that's totally Tolkien.
It when Aragorn finally caught up with Merry and Pippin, and at the edge of Mirkwood, I believe it was, if I'm correct at all.
Sam is a great example.
Sam,
He found the two of them. Was it Gandalf? I can't remember. Oh my god. I'm gonna have to watch it again and read the books. I totally just blew some of my geek points.
No, Lord of the Rings marathon is ended.
Yeah, it is. It's in the works. Director's cut. I deserve it.
Absolutely.
but I believe it was Gandalf who found Merry and Pippin sitting, smoking some of their pipe weed at the edge of Mirkwood, was it? Anyway, he found them sitting somewhere, talking about something, like dinner.
Probably.
And smoking their pipe, and he said, hobbits are, they never, I know it was Gandalf, he said they never cease to amaze me because you can find them sitting on the edge of destruction, or disaster, or whatever, and talking about the weather. And because here they were, you know, the entire world was crumbling around them.
Again,
and they were like, "Well, I do love those scones," you know.
Again, take Sam for an example, because he's like, "Huh, my best friend and longtime companion has given up, literally on a volcano that we're holding pure evil, running from pure evil, probably going to be eaten by pure evil, and I'm gonna carry him to the top."
I feel like Sam should have been the main character of the books.
Well, to many people, he was.
He has his own series.
Sam's awesome.
Before he goes into the West.
But yeah, it's like, you can
take... Spoiler alert!
I think a great reason to have a hobbit in your campaign is, like, if you guys have a... Like the party has a morale problem, or you have characters that are bickering. Like, if you are unfortunate enough to have an elf and a half-orc at the same party... Most of the time, they're not going to agree with most of everything.
You have earned an enemy for life. I'm okay with that.
Right? But a halfling is basically like a party icebreaker.
And he's also a party pacifier. He keeps everybody friends.
Yeah, if you have a gnome and a halfling in the same party, you're fine.
You shouldn't have any... That campaign ain't never gonna have problems. It's gonna be fine.
Party infighting won't really be a thing.
Mm-mm.
Well, one of the coolest compliments that you can give somebody is saying that they have good hobbit sense.
Yeah.
And it's just, know, like, good common sense. That
and, as like, in combat, hobbits can just go through combat with almost no problems.
I think I understand it now. Like, when I first heard them, like, that doesn't make any sense. But
like crazy
they
warriors.
Are... They are so concerned with the delicacies of life that the atrocities of life don't really faze them.
Mm-hmm.
If you fuck up, like, their delicious food, they'll probably lose their mind.
It's like, you know, you never want to be on the opposite side of a hobbit army. You don't want to be there.
No, you don't.
Because hobbits charging with their little swords out, it's like, oh, they're so cute. We're going, oh god.
Well, at the end of the... at the end of the Lord of the Rings, when they invaded the Shire...
That was a bad idea.
It was a bad idea, because those little short bows they had, it made short work of everybody.
Yeah. I don't think anything successfully invaded the Shire for any length of
time.
Well,
I think at one point in time when Galadriel was showing Frodo the visions of the future, mm-hmm. that it actually did happen in the book, they were enslaved by
was Uruk-hai, though.
Well, I'm saying, like, it can happen.
The Uruk-hai enslaved everyone.
I'm saying it can happen, but they fought back, and when they fought back, they fought back hard.
Yes. Well, the thing is, hobbits love house and home. So attacking them at house and home is a terrible idea.
And in the Pathfinder book, they have a +2 racial bonus against fear.
Yeah.
On all their saving throws.
I think they have a...
That's pretty cool.
I think they have a bonus against fear in all of the editions.
Yeah. I don't think so.
Yeah, because it says there they automatically have advantage over fear effects.
In this book?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, then I don't have to look. So, to have a hobbit in your campaign is to bring calmness to your campaign. To bring a tie to your campaign.
To bring, you know, a happier note, really. A very small happy note.
Ding, ding.
Yeah. Yeah, in the middle of the darkness.
Ta-da. So it's a tea. It's a felicita tea.
Yeah, and, you know, you might want to consider... you know, giving them a higher wisdom.
It's like the party, the party could be running from, you know, a wall of zombies, and the hobbit's like, at least they're not fast.
I think the thing that I dislike about hobbits, and this is actually canon to Tolkien, and I think that this is the one problem that I have with that, and that is that they can't see in the dark, and their favorites. I mean, it makes sense for Tolkien hobbits, but for something that branches off of that, I feel like it should be included because their favorite class is the rogue, and I feel like if that's their favorite class, then they should automatically be able to see in the dark. Well, I can't tell you how many times we sent, like, LaRosca out in the middle of that hallway, like, can't see anything!
He's like, hey, go check for traps! I am blind!
Like, the only one of our party who could not see in the dark.
Yeah. They're like, there's another, don't step on that.
It's like, she has traps and she'll be fine. I'm like, I can't see!
Trapsense works when you have eyeballs.
So I feel like that's my biggest pet peeve with halflings in the D&D and Pathfinder series is that they can't see in the dark.
Well, but that's,
well,
that's
first
also,
edition they can.
Honestly, I think...
see if they can.
I think halflings, in my opinion, they should be bards... and fighters, really. Those should be the, probably their two
bards,
main...
Bards, I feel like, should be their main
Honestly,
focus.
A paladin would make sense, too.
Yeah. I mean, Merry and Pippin were pretty much paladins in that campaign.
A hobbit as a paladin of freedom would be perfect.
That would fit so nicely. I feel like they could also be clerics very well.
Yeah.
They focus on other people.
Yes, they're naturally more stealthy, but that doesn't make... Like, in 3.5... In 3.5, the rogue class... should just be to take the rogue, throw that out, and put in thief. Because it's basically what they are.
Well, wasn't that what happened in first edition? They had thief as one of the...
Yeah.
It's like Zorro is a rogue.
Well, I agree. I think, like, bards should be their class of choice. Because they are the type of character who things in life.
In 3.5, bards was given to the gnomes. So I'm okay with them not having that, but they should have more of the courageous classes.
I feel like gnomes should have been sorcerers.
And rangers.
Yeah, like, rangers. Rangers would have been perfect for the gnomes. So I feel like the favorite class of the hobbit should have been changed.
Yeah, I agree.
I don't feel, like, just because they're stealthy, I mean, that's the only reason
Honestly,
that they became rogues.
Honestly, humans should have had a favored class.
Rogues! Rogues would have been perfect for humans!
In all stories ever, humans usually are rogues!
They're cunning, they're snide, manipulative.
Take a fantasy universe and find a human, and he's most likely got a long cape, a hood, a dagger in his boot, and he's got those weird little frilly
boots. Just described Strider.
I just basically described every human in fantasy ever.
I agree with you. I think that humans, because they're always, like, the bad guy of the situation, they're always the manipulative part of any story whatsoever. And I feel like, hobbits, they like the finer things in life.
I like
so
hobbits.
So they should have been bards.
But they also have simple tastes.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that's a bard!
Hobbits are straightforward people. They like what they like, and there's not much they don't like.
And they like song, they like dance, they like storytelling.
They're very happy people.
The first, 20 minutes of the first Lord of the Rings movie is the perfect example why their favorite class should have been bards.
Yep.
Fireworks.
Fireworks.
So, I think that is really,
pretty much it.
Really in depth.
I think it's unanimous. We like hobbits.
Yeah, hobbits
are
pretty
cool.
Hobbits are pretty cool.
They're always welcome at the tavern.
Except these guys.
Yeah, the miniature elves.
Miniature elves.
Now, see, here's another thing. apparently, I think what did it...
These guys are like a personification of an ideal of something that's supposed to happen.
Well, there was a series, and I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with it. It's the Dragonlance series by Margaret Weiss and Tracy Hickman, which I never really cared for it. They had a race of characters, a race of people called the Kinder. And the Kinder were the miniature elves. They were compulsive thieves. They were little psychos, little sociopathic, little psycho bastards, and I hated them. And it really ruined the whole image.
Honestly, I'd probably kill them on sight.
I would too.
Well, they're like
I can't help it. It's my nature. Well, this is mine.
The fae known as the brownie. The brownie.
Yeah.
The fae.
Uh-huh.
That's a kinder.
That's a kinder.
You kill those on sight.
You kill them immediately.
You kill them on premise. The brownies are
yeah, I never
basically a little micro-fae.
Whenever I hear this, the
I think term, like brownie.
No, no, whenever I hear the term brownie in word of Fae, I think of the shoemaker in that Christmas story.
Yeah.
Like, that's what I think of when I think brownie.
Well, yeah, and that's...
Miniature human.
I think it was
a little keyboard elves.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I think of when I think
keyblers.
I think it was at that point that the halflings took the turn from the chubby children in appearance to the miniature elf. And I never liked them after that.
However, I feel like once we start getting into 5th edition here at the Tavern, really hardcore, I feel like it'll kind of rekindle that love for hobbits and halflings.
Definitely. Well, see, when I play, when I play a halfling, ever since, I've never accepted the miniature elf as canon. So anytime we play a halfling here at the Tavern, we play the traditional halfling.
Because they're actually just far more entertaining.
I feel like
you need far more different types of personalities with these characters.
The elf is the utmost beauty. It is the epitome of grace and finesse and wonder.
And
whenever humans, whenever real life humans think of anything fantasy, they automatically attribute them to be somewhat like the elves.
Because elves are just basically everything a human wants to look like.
Exactly. So when they create other races, they want them to be prettier like the elves. And I feel like that had a big part in that creation.
If you wanted to get an actual photograph of an elf, you just go get an issue of Cosmopolitan and rip out some of those smelly ads with the perfume in it.
If you want to get a picture of an elf, just hold up a piece of paper that absorbs light, just hold it at them, and it will copyright on.
Photosensitive paper. Okay, so hopefully this has given you some insight into the end of the whole
thing. Or at least our insight.
Our insight, let you know how we think. And if you disagree, let us know. Leave us some comments.
Absolutely.
And tell us what you think. How do you like halflings before, during, and since? Well, the old...
Yeah, I understand what you mean. Okay. Weird way to put it.
It is.
You said before twice, then.
Before, during, and since. Or after. After what? I don't know. Who cares? but anyway, let us know your thoughts. We always love hearing from you guys.
If you have any ideas for any videos whatsoever, please comment below.
Because
we are also going to tackle those.
Absolutely. We got a lot more videos. I got a lot more reviews, and she's got some reviews to do, and he and I have got a new series that we're going to bring on.
Look forward to that.
Yeah, me too. I think it's going to be fun. So,
I take some notes.
I have been and will continue to be Dr. Jeff Goins.
And I have been and will continue to be Lyric.
I have been and will continue to be Ian.
Most likely. And we, on behalf of the entire cast and crew of the Dwarven Tavern, wish for you to want for nothing but adventure. And at first I feared it,
then I charged.
Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.